Ham Radio Now, episode 169. DVB-T, digital video. It's from the DCC back in Austin, Texas in September. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, finally back here in the main Ham Radio Now studios, reconfigured just a little bit and with a beer on my lap. We'll talk about that a little bit more later on. In episode 168, Ken Konecki, W6HHC, described his stuff, the DATV Express, a transmitter, really an exciter, low power, needs an amp, for digital amateur radio television. And while the DATV Express is software-defined, it can run several modes, Ken's group had focused on something called DVB-S. That stands for Digital Video Broadcasting Satellite. As you might guess, it's a digital video format used for shipping video up and down from satellites. I think I'd mentioned that there's a bunch of digital video formats. Here in the U.S., we use something called ATSC. The initials stand for the Advanced Television Standards Committee. You remember back in the old days of analog TV, we had NTSC, and now we're advanced. Yay. Well, you know, it's all digital, which means, I suppose, that there's an infinite number of ways to put these signals together. And more practically, there are a handful of formats in common use for broadcasting television. That concept may sound familiar to hams who are trying to decide if they want to run D-Star or Yaesu System Fusion or DMR Moto Turbo or P25 or NXDN or maybe sometime soon, FreeDV. Back to television. Over in Europe, nobody uses ATSC. In fact, almost nobody outside of North America uses ATSC. Most of Europe uses something called DVB-T. I think I've got a map here. DVB-T is Digital Video Broadcasting Terrestrial. There's a few others. This map shows what's in use where. See over here, North America, ATSC. All this blue stuff is DVB-T and a couple of other little formats in use here and there. Oh, by the way, this website is from something called ChinaVision. Just looking things up and trying to find a map, and I found that one. Okay, so satellite, terrestrial. Well, they're similar. Each has advantages and disadvantages, and I'm not an expert enough to be able to talk about that. The good news, though, is that we hams can use any of that stuff, plus or minus some codec licensing issues. Hey, Bear, how you doing? Bear's getting antsy. In this program, Mel Whitten, K0PFX, is going to talk about DVB-T, the terrestrial version, and he's going to show you a bunch of equipment that's not all that hard to put together to get on the air. So maybe, blatantly stealing a line from Charles Osgood, maybe someday I'll see you on the radio. Before I push the button to start Mel, though, I want to thank the folks that have made this series of programs possible from the DCC, our Kickstarter backers, and we begin with the 108 hams who contributed between $10 and $150 as individuals. And then we've got our $500 corporate underwriters. These are the guys who put in the big money to get this little pat on the back. They are
Adam Curry, John C. Dvorak.
It's Sunday, September 7th, 2014. Time for your Gitmo Nation Media Assassination, episode 650.
This is No Agenda.
Adam Curry is KF5SLN. He is one of the hosts of the No Agenda show, along with John C. Dvorak, who is KJ6LNG. The No Agenda Show is a twice-weekly audio podcast. Those two guys take apart politics, the media, entertainment, anything that needs to be taken out and beaten. I wrote that line. They didn't give it to me. But at least Adam very much likes ham radio. John keeps giving you that strange look, but Adam really loves ham radio. You can listen to them on their website, thenoagendashow.com, or you can dial up No Agenda Show on most podcasting apps. We're also brought to you by Tapper. They sponsor the DCC, of course. If you're interested in anything in digital in amateur radio, that's hardware, software, data, voice, I suppose I should say, or television, you'll be at home in Tapper. And if you're getting a lot out of the DCC videos and you're not already a Tapper member, please consider joining. Stop by their website, tapper.org, and check them out. are also brought to you by some hams who want you to check out this group. It is hackersforcharity.org. They're a nonprofit organization. They leverage the skills of technologists. Well, that's a handful of words to say they want you to help to solve technology challenges for various nonprofits. They provide food, equipment, job training, and computer education for some of the world's poorest citizens. They are hackersforcharity.org. So you might be able to help out with your skills. Stop by the website. You can see what you might be able to do for them. What you might be able to do for them sitting right in front of your computer at home. Okay, we're also brought to you by the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force. And they are at aretf.org. Their mission is to make amateur radio digital networks work better by providing high-quality, relevant technical documents that influence the way people design, use, and manage amateur radio networks. Very carefully worded to tell you that they're not trying to tell you what to do, but they're trying to tell you what you can do. So if you're involved in a digital network and you're wondering if there's any standards to guide you, or you want to contribute to the development of those standards and recommendations, check out the Amateur Radio Engineering Task Force, aretf.org. And finally, we're brought to you by an enthusiastic supporter of Ham Radio Now and Tapper on the DCC, who wishes to remain anonymous. It's a ham who's been a regular attendee at the DCC for over 30 years, very enthusiastic about what the DCC and Ham Radio Now are doing together. So thanks to him and to all of you people. And if you didn't contribute to the Kickstarter, but you find yourself appreciating what we do here on Ham Radio Now, stop by our website, hamradionow.tv. Oh, no, I'm covering up Arvin. There he is. Arvin, our mascot. You'll find his icon on the website. Just click the little piggy bank. He'll take you to our contributions page, and you can use PayPal or a credit card. And my thanks to everyone who has contributed to Ham Radio Now and the Kickstarter. And enough of the pitching and pledging. Let's get down to Austin, Texas, and Tapper President Steve Bible, N7HPR, will introduce Mel.
All right, everybody, let's go ahead and we'll get started with the next talk. I'd like to introduce Mel Whitten, K0PFX, and his talk on digital video broadcasting T for ham radio. Take it away, Mel.
Okay, thank you. Good morning. Glad to be here again. I've switched horses and raised bit rates. This was to be an introductory talk, so this may be a little bit introductory for some of you, but I felt that some of it need to be explained for those that haven't dwelled into digital video for ATV. I just got started earlier this year, so I'm a newbie myself. But I found it very intriguing, very interesting, and I think you will too. So here we'll talk a little bit about what it is, why I use it, and the transmit and receive signal chain for DVB, and how to build your own station using some very economical hardware available now. A little bit about the software you'll need with it, some resources, and hopefully a demo. So DVB-T was introduced in the UK or Sweden, depending on which history book you read, around 1998. It was a standard that was worked on. It's available now from ETS's website, EN700-344. It's very dry reading, but it's an open standard. It uses modern compression techniques. It's very efficient modulation schemes, and it delivers a standard and HD video. Ken made a few remarks about why we use digital video. DVB-T certainly stands behind that. It's more robust in weak signal conditions. It requires a lot less power. It's very spectrum efficient. And there's none of this analog ghosting, as you may remember, if any of you have operated analog TV with never the same color, NTSC. And you always have a good picture with it once you have lock. There's now readily available low-cost software It's been available just in this past year. I found this graph. I'm not sure who developed this graph. I found it, but I didn't find the author. But it holds very true to DVB-T and digital signals. If you've operated any analog signal from P0 is nothing but snow to P5 is a perfect picture with no snow, about 6 dB jumps from P1 through P5. And I've found that you have a good lock signal around P2. That's a very snowy picture on analog. At home, I run relatively low power, 8 to 10 watts. And to get the same signal, I have to run 70 to 80 watts on analog, and still not even really a P5 picture, even at that power. So I found that very intriguing. So before the 1990s, here's a little bit of history. It just wasn't technically or economically possible to digitize TV. We didn't have fast computers back then. We didn't have the memory available. But finally, the manufacturers found, you know, there's going to be a lot of money in this, so let's throw some money and get it developed, which is what they did during the 80s and 90s. And the MPEG, which provided the codec for compressing it, came about. And we have MPEG 1 and then MPEG later 2. DVB utilized that. And the standard was finally developed by the Electronics Launching Group in 1993. So by the late 90s, there was three variants of DVB-T, satellite, mobile, and terrestrial. And now I think there's five or six of them. But we'll dwell on the terrestrial here. And later we had MPEG-4, H.264, AVC, as you know, was developed for HDTV. So now I'm going to look at how the DVB picture is sent and received. But we're going to look at it from the source fed into MPEG and then the output of the picture to the television set rather than looking at it from the transmit and receive end. And I'll go over these blocks in the transmit chain and briefly go over it in the complementary of that in the receive chain from the MPEG to multiplexing of all of the streams to the forward error correction that's done, and the modulation, and then the IF up conversion in down to the transmitter. But I'd like to talk to you a little bit about a few of the parameters that's required for DVB-T, because if you get into this and you start looking at some of the software, you're going to be suddenly, you're going to have to know about how to set some of these parameters for the picture, although it gives you a pretty good way to determine this. At the lower right here, you'll see the modulator output data rate, and that's about 2 megabits. And here's the file input rate. As these are controlled up here, it will control these down here. So we're going to be looking at these, and I'm highlighting these in the transmit output chain to give you an idea later on. What will be needed to make these adjustments in the software. So we'll look at MPEG coding. Again, this is fairly highlighted, but that provides a data compression. Otherwise, it reduces about 6 times for standard, another 5 or 6 for HD. So without it, we wouldn't have ATV today. MPEG does that prediction and movement compensation. By looking at the picture before and the picture afterwards and only looking at the data that changed within the picture. So they saved a lot of bits doing that. And there's a lot of other things that MPEG did, but it basically compresses the data for the audio, video, and what's called private data into these elementary streams, and there can be a number of them of those. They're finally packetized in what's called a program elementary stream, or the PES. And that's sent up to be multiplexed. And the multiplexing packetizes these to the payload, that's the picture, the data, the audio, into this transport stream, the TS, and eventually sent on the transmitter. And the packet length's relatively short, 188 bytes, which is used because of forward error correction and Reed Solomon in particular. That goes on to be, the packets are then sent to be corrected with Reed-Solomon and Fournier convolutional interleaving, which corrects bursts and other data errors, and has five rates that it can apply this code rate. One half gives you a good 100%. But of course, this is all overhead down to 9%. Typically, what I've found is the more forward error correction you have, you're certainly going to have a better chance of getting your signal through in weak signal conditions. However, it does add quite a bit of latency, much more than the 1 second or so that Ken just mentioned. However, once you're on the air, it doesn't really make any difference. Except some for voice applications, you get out of lip sync. That has happened fairly often. Forward error correction must be balanced, as I mentioned, between the payload data, the data rate needed, the signal robustness requirement, and the available bandwidth. A DAC then, a linear DAC, converts the data in phase to our INQ, and then that's mixed to produce the final output for the modulator. And then the INQ is sent to be modulated. The modulation is used for coded orthogonal frequency division multiplexing. There's many discrete carriers from 2 to 8, although we're limited to 6. Normally we only run 2 megahertz bandwidth. The 3 modulations are QPSK, will give us 2 bits, 4 bits, and 16 bits. Normally, we run QPSK, obviously, because it's more robust. The QPSK's lowest bit error rate and bits per second from QPSK to 64 bits. It's our highest is at 64. So it's a trade-off between bit rate and robustness. There are 2 carrier modes. Ken mentioned one of them earlier, the 2K, which gives us up to 1,700 useful carriers. There's, of course, some scattered pilots in there, and some continual pilots, which take up about 10% of the carriers. But we use 8K because it's this 8K runs at a lot lower symbol rate, which makes it a lot more robust in multipath fading. Actually, it works even pretty well mobile, as Ken and some other people have tested this. And FEC has, or CFBN has a guard interval to reduce the inter-symbol interference, and it's adjustable in 4 rates. All of this will be found in the software later on, that adjustments that the user has to make for setting up a DVB-T to transmit. So then it's the signal sent up to the, be up converted to the transmitter. The transport stream then is it's amplified and sent out to the antenna. And the receive chain is basically a reverse of that. It's down converted, demodulated, A to DC, and then demultiplex and back up to the MPEG decoder through all those streams, and then out comes the picture. I just wanted to give you a quick overview of MPEG because that's very important for a DVB, otherwise it wouldn't be available today. So let's look at getting on the air with DVB-T. It's relatively easy today with today's technology, and so I want to show you how we can do that. A basic station, of course, just includes the camera. In this case, we have some products from a company over in Taiwan I want to talk to you about. My bag of tricks here, I'll find the camera that a lot of us use. And it includes a demodulator and transmitter, this size right here. It has a switch on the back for setting a bunch of parameters already for you, or you can set your parameters and program them in a little SD card and plug the card back in. Runs off of 5 volts. So this one's used a lot for the because it's very simple to use. Run that right into the amplifier, and there you go. No software required. Class A amplifier, obviously. I will talk a little bit more about the actual amplifier, a receiver available. This is without use of any computer. It's this size right here, has a HDMI output, this complete receiver right here for DVB-T. So you have your microphone, your receiver, and the microphone transmitter and modulator all in this camera here, and this is your receiver. And Yagi for 70 centimeters, whatever normally around 434 to 439 megahertz is where ETVs found in your area. There they are. There's a OSD for controlling it remotely. And it's from a company called Hi-Dez. Let's see if I can bring them up here. They are in Taiwan, although they speak very good English. They've been very helpful for ham radio operators. I think one of the guys works there must be from the U.S. They've been very helpful for any changes that we would like to see in the camera and specifically in the receiver. They're making a new camera right now, which should be out shortly. So let's look at the receiver. It decodes SD through HD through 1080p. Looks at MPEG 1 through 4. HDI and composite output. It includes the ham radio narrow modes down to 1 megahertz. There's a little switch on the back for the ham modes. And it has an OSD, as I mentioned, for remote. And it goes from 170 to 950 megahertz in one kilohertz steps. So you can set it on any amateur frequency there on 430. But normally ATV is run, there's a low end and a high end from 422 to 439 megahertz. KH6HTV, he did some sensitivity adjustments on it, or sensitivity tests on it, and found the QPSK mode to be at minus 102 dBm at 2 megahertz bandwidth. Of course, that changes quite a bit as you widen your bandwidth out to 6 megahertz at 64 QAM. So unless you have a lot of signal, you probably won't be able to run that wide a bandwidth. But again, that's not really needed anyway. And it runs on 5 volts, 300 mils. The camera, his output is about one milliwatt, plenty to drive an amplifier. It has a 2 millimeter lens, about a 66 degree field view. Again, it does the compression and 30 frames per second. And this one will go up to the 23 centimeter band, 1200 to 1300, and ATV operates around 1258, somewhere in there. 2 to 8 megahertz bandwidth. And again, the parameters can either be set by a switch or through the micro SD card. Here's an amplifier that was developed specifically for the Hi-Dez modules from OE7DBH. There's a 4-watt and a 10-watt version. I've got the 10 watts, and I run between 8 and 10 watts with it. It uses a Mitsubishi block. It's actually a 60-watt RF-FM block, but it you can set it so that with a lower input and setting the drain quiescent current with the gate voltage and control the output with the input power. So that's worked out quite well for ATV. There's also another one available from K6HTV. And this one's been around for quite a while. That will also work with the Hi-Dez modules. So a simple station is basically an HDTV, or you just run a standard definition, HDMI output into the right in the input of the receiver. You can switch it. You can use just an antenna switch if you want, or a relay, and switch it to the amplifier, the camera, being your drive for the amplifier, and then up to a normally use the Yagi antenna horizontally polarized. Now, to add a little more station capability, then Hi-Des makes a dongle, and it's this size right here. It has a full duplex. I'll talk a little bit more about it here. These antenna connections on the back using MCX connectors. Again, a Class A amplifier, a Yagi for 70 centimeters, and you can use a camera that you've got built in, or a USB camera like this Logitech right here plugged in the side of my PC here, and that's my camera for this. Or I can use the desktop. So it's USB based. It has a full hardware implementation of DVB-T, and it's it can be operated in full duplex capability. And full duplex is really nice because one station can be on 70 centimeters, the other one on 23. You can both be transmitting and receiving at the same time, so you're talking back and forth and seeing each other. That's really that's the way to go with ATV. And this, something like this will provide that, allow you to do that. And again, it has the ham version, actually down to 1 megahertz. The guys, and the French, I think, especially, and some of the other European stations are down to running 1 megahertz. They run a lot of still pictures at that bandwidth, but it's capable of doing it. This one does go up to 23 centimeters as well as 70 centimeters. Again, supports full HD, H.264, and MPEG. So adding it, you have the output of the receive and transmitter out of the UT100, which there is a bunch of these modules. Again, down to an antenna switch to the amplifier. And in this case, we're adding a camera to the PC. And it's always a good idea to have a preamp, obviously. And BIAS-T is a way of providing the power up to the preamp, so you don't have to run wires up there for power of it. Well, that's basically what I'm using, something very similar to that, with this K1 FO Yagi, which is a very fine antenna because of the nice flat bandwidth that it has, great for ATV. Well, there's some free software available. It's all provided by Hi-Des, and there's a BDA Viewer Plus, which is a receive and record review. You can not only receive video, but of course you can record it and play it back to your buddies. There's another one called a transport player. And you can take any of your video files that you have in other formats and use a converter to make them into a transport file. And then you can play those on your PC. So there's a lot of room for any type of content that you need, which is usually when you get on ATV, you'll find out, well, what am I going to send next? You know, they're tired of looking at me. So you're able to send anything as well from your desktop. We'll take a look at that here in a moment. And others, there's another program called Digital TV for receiving and recording files. So quite a bit of software out there. However, for those that do like to program, there is an API available for both Windows and Linux, and there's Windows and Linux SDK programmer's guides, and I've seen those. They're fairly complete, so there is a chance for those that can program to be able to write programs for something that they want to do with these modules. Using the ITE is the name of the company that makes the chips for these. I think of them as very smart chips, because they do an awful lot in just this size. And there's a bunch of different ones of these modules. We'll take a look at eBay where these are available here in a moment. So this is my station here. I made a box down there below. It's called the DVB-T-10W. And here I can switch in and out an external, second receiver like the like this one right here, the HV1110. Of course, I have the UT100 built inside of it. Just run a USB cable down from the PC. I've got a 10-watt amplifier above that. You can see the heat sink up there, watt meter on the side, and a sequencer for the amplifier, which really isn't needed, but it was available, so I'm using it, and a 20-amp power supply. So that that gives you a lot of versatility in just a few modules for an ATV station. There's another picture of it there. I've been asked to write some articles for it. Larry's mentioned something. He thought this may be of interest. So I do have it pretty well documented from the standpoint of a full set of drawings for it. So perhaps I'll do that. Here's the inside of it. It's basically just some relay switching. The UT100Bs over here on the right, it's plugged into a converter right here, an USB-F connector coming in here. Here's a relay over here that I do some switching for the camera in and out. I'm using a digital voltmeter here, and it uses a great big, what do they call it? I'm trying to think. Well, anyway, it's a shunt, a large shunt down here for it. And I'm using a power relay over here. Here's the amplifier, the 10-watt amplifier. And I opened it up, and the heat sink's out here. Well, that's basically it. Some connectors on the back, switches to turn off and on things, including the fans. I won't go over this, but this is basically the schematic of it. Again, some RF relays, a couple of fans over here, and here's the sequencer, mass-mounted preamp, and so forth. I added another circuit here so I could switch the receiver in and out as well. And here's Ken had shown us, this is the DVB output, the 1700 carriers here. It has a nice shoulder, flat top signal, and it's down about 40, 45 dB down. This is the output at 1 milliwatt.
Capital is megawatt.
Milliwatts. What have I got? Megawatt? I wish, yeah. I wish it was a megawatt, right. Yeah. Here it is again. Now we've got a little bit of IMD here, but I'm running about 10 watts here. Actually, I'm at 4 megahertz instead of 2 megahertz here. But it's still a nice, clean signal. And again, I'm just amazed as how well this works versus analog ATV. You would not think you would be able to receive a signal as weak as what it appears to be. But it locks in and it works just fine. Oh, here's some of the signal. I think some of these were over relatively long paths, 70, 80 mile paths, and yet you have a good digital signal. Great color, so much better than NTSC. So where to find this? We'll look at Hyde's site here on eBay. There's some of the modules there. You can get transmit only, or receive only, different bandwidths. They do a lot of closed circuit TV, I guess, where they want to distribute ATV over a wide area. They use these different modules to do that. And then they get into more some commercial ones. There's a companion that it appears to me they really developed for hams for this receiver here, and it will not require any PC connection other than to set the parameters. So I'm kind of looking forward to that. Although there are some guys that have bought these more expensive ones. There's one $500 or $600 here. But to get into analog today, if you just go out and buy a PC electronics, you're spending $500 or $600 just to get on analog. So these are still priced, very competitively. There's some more of them there. So they're really into this. It's a very interesting that they, there's the receiver down here. It's $169. This module here is $230. And the camera, which is not, you didn't see it on there, there's been a new one developed for it. It was under $200 for the camera. So very competitively priced, I think. So you're probably thinking now, is this something you want to do or can you do? And I think you really can. You know, it's fairly easy to do, I think. As I mentioned, I just got started in this March or April. I had been following some of the work that Ken did, and it just seemed awful complicated to me at the time, you know, whether I want to get into this digital stuff or not. I had all this analog working, and I was so proud of it, you know. And then I started looking at some of those pictures other people are doing, and I'm thinking, holy mackerel, you know, I got to look into this. So that's what got me started into it. Ken had mentioned some of these, but the Yahoo groups have been very helpful here. There's also a magazine called the ATV Television Quarterly. Hope I brought that. Yeah. This magazine here is very good. It's put out quarterly. Ken's written a number of articles in it. And they talk a lot about their repeaters. There's been repeaters built now. There's one up at Dayton. At the Dayton Amateur Radio Club has a repeater. They're using this receiver on their repeater, and it's working quite well for them. Most of the repeaters are both analog and digital. It senses what the signal is and then switches depending on what your mode is that you're running. And Ken mentioned the British Amateur Television Club. They do some kind of, I thought, unique things, interesting. They actually do streaming video. You can go to their website, and certain times of the day, this streamer right here, you can see guys on the air. Also repeaters. I don't know if we'll find one on today. Let's see. ATV repeaters. As Ken mentioned, there's a lot of guys on in England, and VKLN and ZLN. Well, you know, unlike us, they have DVB. That's what they use. Where here we have the ATSC. And ATSC, I looked into that a long time ago. My Lord, you know, there's no transmitters for it. And once you did find some, you know, as Ken mentioned, it's $1,000 just to be able to transmit a picture. So let's see if there's anybody on here. There's some currently, I don't know. I'm just taking a guess. I don't know. Ken, would you know if there's any guys? Let's see.
I think the top list is currently streaming.
Okay, let's see. I think it's yeah, and it has a chat channel here on the side. Maybe you have to hit watch here. And I made no arrangement to see if anybody was around or not. But anyway, if it was streaming, they would be showing up right here. We got a few more minutes here. I'm going to get you out early for lunch. Let me go back here and see if there's one.
GB3HV appears to be live.
Pardon me? Yeah, there we go. And I don't know if that's kind of hard to tell from here, but I think that's a repeater that they're running right now. And most repeaters, they may be on all the time, you know, just running some content that they have in them. So anyway, I'll give you some place to go and you can see, you know, what activity is going on there. I thought it was, you know, quite interesting to see that, and as many of them as there are. Okay, so our good friend Vic Poor spoke here many times. This is when the enabling technology is in place, the next thing is going to happen. And I think we're finally getting that technology in place, you know, with things like this. And old Wayne Green said about packet radios, you remember, he says, talk about it as if everybody's doing it, and eventually they will be. So and that's what happened. All right. Next, I'm going to try a little demo, and I'm going to use this DVB dongle. Actually, I don't need an antenna, but I will show you. I'm just going to put it in transmitter. Those are little MCX connectors. They give you these antennas just for testing. So stick that over there. I'm going to plug the DV dongle into the USB port here. Unfortunately, they interfere, so I've got to add a little bit of cable, which I have here in my bag of tricks. I'm just going to extend this. By the way, you can extend this way out of, you know, whatever the USB specification is. I run it about 10 feet away at my station. I've got it plugged in now. Interestingly, it doesn't make any beep or anything when you plug it in or out, so, but always seems to work until I try to do a demo. We got audio on, so let's see here. We'll end this. And as I mentioned, when you first start out, some people are a little shy maybe of the camera. So, let's run something that I made, or, you know, some non-proprietary subject. And they've got this file converter here. And you just put in a file of whatever you have, and then you click on it, and you can convert that into a transport file, and then you can play that back. So I've got some of those done. I'm going to bring up first the transport player. As I mentioned earlier, yeah, I think you can see those okay. You need to know what bandwidth it is you want to run. There's your frequency in kilohertz, and there's your code rate, what modulation. And you have to pay particular attention to whatever your input is. Here's your transport file input data rate, a little over 2 megabits per second here, and here's your modulator output. It's just a little bit higher. Obviously, it needs to be higher than what your input is. So if you play with these, say, oh, well, let me see if I can have a little bit more, change it to 16 QAM. Well, obviously, your output's way up higher than your input, so you're okay there. Now, if you went to, say, a lower code rate, then you would find out, whoops, I don't have an, I did hit the wrong one here. You don't, your modulator output rate's higher than your input rate, so that wouldn't work. So let's go back to 2/3, I think. Let's see. Is 19. Get it back to where I had it. Oh, let's see. 3/4. Okay, they're about the same. The 8K transmission rate, that's really best, again, because it's most robust in fighting echoes as a result of multipath. So, all right, we've got this one set up. There is a bunch of other options in under advanced, but I won't get into those at the moment. I'm going to run a viewer now. It's really, these programs really weren't made to run at the same time on one PC, but it will work. Normally you would have these running separately. But it does show that you can run full duplex. So I'm going to run see if I get the levels here. I've got audio here too, so I may either blast you out or you may not hear it. Hit the run command down here. And it starts running here.
I'm going to try to record.
This is a recording made by a fellow up in Dayton. Just really short. But this is a 2 megahertz wide bandwidth. You see it's got great color.
I'm going to try to record.
And we'll stop it, and I'll run one that that I made. I've got it in a mode where it just continuously runs over and over. So we'll stop it here. Go to this browser here. Here's different ones that I've made or received. I'll go to a demo of showing you my station, and also a recording that was made of my station. We'll go down here. We'll start it.
You're on the air.
Oh, Okie doke. This is Mel K0PFX in Ham Shack. And we're using a high-res digital video broadcasting gear and being recorded by Agarian Zero GL over in 15
That's
miles
this
away
camera.
Over St. Charles. I'm in,
and the microphone in the camera.
About 10 or 15 minutes from downtown Ferguson. And we're running about 8 watts. And using the high def camera.
It's jerky because of this PC. If I'd start over, it'd probably be all right.
And we're running at 2 megahertz. Very spectrum efficient compared to analog. And you can see a little bit of the shack here. I'm using the high def standalone receiver and also the one in the UT100. Show you the homebrew setup that I've got for digital video broadcastings in this box right here, where I have the UT100B. We're drawing about 10 amps and we're running about a 8-9 watts output. So that's the shack here. And Gary, I hope you got the recording okay. I'm just holding the camera here, so thanks, Gary. Over N0GL, K0PFX.
Okay, that gave you an idea of what you can do with these dongles and a little receiver. That's digital video broadcasting. I can also show you, but I think you probably want to get to lunch here shortly. We can show, I'll make one quick one here, running another program called PC to TV. And this one allows more capability on a configuration. You can go to the source, and then you can use your desktop as a source, and anything that you run on that desktop can be the content. Or video capture here using a camera or whatever device you plug into it automatically finds it, audio down there. So I'll bring up a program called Digital TV. This one, has also capability. I'll start and run it. And this is a just a active view window to show what it is that you're looking at here. Boy, it doesn't like the lighting in here from the fluorescent lights. You'll find in your ham shack that you want to get some good daylight lighting so you look a little bit better. But we'll start it here. And it takes a few seconds. There's a latency in some of these modes. Hope we'll run it here. Guess I had it run. Okay, now we'll play this one. Get an idea what the camera looks like. Hopefully, yeah, we'll run it. There we go. Give you an idea there. You can put your call sign up here where it says ITE Channel 1. As far as it has electronic program guide, EPG. Let's see if it's still running or not. Sometimes it locks up here when I'm trying to run both of these programs at the same time. Okay, that gave you an idea. Again, you can use your USB camera. Use the one that you've got in your laptop or whatever as well. All righty. Okay. That about does it for the demo, unless you have some something else you want to see with the programs. You know, those again, they're free. They come with the high des, and they're updated. I've had them updated a couple of times. So, all righty. Any questions?
Paul Cecil, KA5FPT, mm-hmm. With the dongle and the transmitters as wide as their bandwidth, has there been problems with unclean signals? Do you have to run extra filtering?
I haven't, no. Mm-mm. I thought the same thing. I'd already looked up for some filters, but I haven't had any problems. Again, you know, there are some repeaters fairly close to us. You know, it's conceivable that could happen, especially up at 1300 up in there. There's some radar not too far from us. FAA radar once in a while drifts down into our shared band. You can have interference problems there, yeah. Any other questions?
Do you have a copy of this presentation with the links online or on a web page?
I'm gonna put it on. Yeah, Ken asked me. We're gonna provide it, all these slides and the link. It'll be available on Tappers. Yeah.
Have you had any experience with fades and dropouts, and how does it handle? You know, how does it behave when that happens?
When it drops out, it doesn't pixelate. It just the picture. Picture just freezes, and then it'll pop back up again. Once in a while, you will see, I have seen some, it looks like tearing in it, but that was some problem that I had. I was doing something wrong in the shack, but normally it just drops down and comes back up again. That digital cliff is just a few dB, the difference between lock and unlock.
Yeah, I was wondering, what did you say the distances you were transmitting, and what about line of sight and...
I'm sorry.
The distances that you were transmitting, uh-huh. How far?
Oh, how far? The video recording you saw that was made by Gary, he's about 15 miles from me, not line of sight, a lot of vegetation in between us. Some guys have made through tropospheric ducting. I know of one path that was 183 miles, I think, they made. So it's possible to do relatively long pass, but it's not uncommon to do 30 or 40 miles.
Was that 433?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? If not, we'll let you get to lunch. All right. Thank you very much.